Okay, so, you got something for me?
Yeah, I got something for you. Let's do some business.
Yeah, I got something for you, too.
All right, good. That's what we're here for.
How do I know what you got for me?
Well, you're gonna know what I got when you show me what you got.
Well, I ain't gonna show you what I got for you till you show me what you got for me.
Well, now that's a problem.
Well, maybe they don't match up so good, what we got for each other.
Maybe they match perfect, man.
How can we tell?
This might be beautiful. This might be beautiful.
You know?
Well, let me see.
So I got something for you.
Right.
You got something for me. We don't know how these two things match up, though. If one is enough or if the other is enough.
That's what we got to find out.
How are we going to know what you got? We got for each other till we show it? We got to show it to each other.
Together. We got to agree.
This ain't going to work. How do people do this?
I don't know. Maybe we just...
I didn't learn this in school.
I didn't either, man.
This is a dilemma.
Yeah.
We might be able to work this out pretty good, but I ain't going to show you.
I ain't going to show you.
But I got to show you.
I got to
show
you.
You got to show me, but you ain't going to do it, are you?
No.
That's a damn shame.
Man, it could have been beautiful.
Hi, I'm Peter Donalds, and this is the Neo Radio Hour, home of independent writers, musicians, home tapers, the folk artists of the electronic age. We've got the usual eclectic mix of scenes, stories, sound sculpture, and music, including a few Neo bits from our own studios. Regulars, Frank the Courier and Mr. Sunshine are here. And in conversation, it's writer and performer Kathy Goss. We won't be afraid to show you ours if you won't be afraid to show us yours. It's the Neo Radio Hour. Independent audio art.
Think about sex. I think about other things too, like my career, my car's dirty oil, and any number of catchy phrases. You should have seen me before I met you. Nothing ever balanced. But now I can count all your tiny pounds and still slip a foot on the scale. I've brought some special fingers with me just to handle the situation. I've been at it for a long time, but I've never seen anything like this. Your hair, it's a traceable explosion, like a toaster. Every excuse is twisted, so I'm taking my time. Life is noisy and saturated, and no matter what happens, I'm not going to forget these days, nights, minutes, positions.
I'm Frank, the courier. Now, I'm not a spy or anything like that. I just pass things around. I was on assignment in San Francisco at the Dragon Boat Festival. I was supposed to meet a guy by the name of Disco Johnny Chang near the karaoke booth. It was pretty groovy until the speakers broke. I thought I'd find another spot. I was approached by a guy with a very impressive haircut. You named Frankie? Yeah, that's me. You named Johnny? That's me. Got a light? Sure. Yeah, smoking them cools, huh? You got a cold, Johnny? No, I got something for you, though. Yeah, I'll take it. He slipped me a tape and went on his way. Quick job. Easy day. I was admiring the handiwork on the San Francisco Fire Department's Dragon Boat. And who do I see on stage but Disco Johnny, performing an interesting interpretation of Smoke Gets in Your Eyes.
All who loves are bright. Oh, when your heart's on fire, you must realize smoke gets in your eyes. So I checked them and I gave laugh. You think they without my love. Yet today my love has flown away. I am without my
Johnny. Huh. Yeah, pretty good singing there, Penny.
I'm Frank.
Hey, you ever get
the courier. No, I'm not a spy or anything like that. I just pass things around.
You're great.
You know, I go back to this job every once in a while just because of the characters you can run into.
And if you need a bicycle.
Okay, fine. We go out. We go karaoke. Good time. Yeah, okay. I'll meet you at Bush and Mason around 9:30.
只要一死无心感苦潮流起风化风随便偷换潮流起风不知动作新机本还有意愿 The Neo Radio Hour.
Secondhand furniture store, and I've been think my prices are fair. Cause this real cheap guy I know came in the other day, saw this chair he wanted to buy, but he wouldn't, claimed the price was too high. So I looked him straight in the eye, and this was my reply. Darling, if I can't sell it, then I'm gonna sit back down on it. Why should I give it away? Now, sugar, if you want it, then you're gonna have to buy it. And I mean just what I say. Now, how'd you like to find this waiting for you every night? Only been used once or twice, so it's still nice and tight. Wow! But darling, if I can't sell it, then I'm gonna keep sitting on it. I ain't about to give it away. Now, you can't find a better pair of legs in town. Mm-mm. And a back like this, woo, honey, not for miles around. And that is why, if I couldn't sell it, then I'm gonna recline upon it. Now you tell me, why should I give it away? Because it's made for comfort, built for wear and tear. Where else you gonna find such an easy chair? But darling, if I can't sell it, I'm gonna sit on it. This nice bottom, ain't it easy on the eye? Guaranteed to support any weight or size. But honey, if I can't sell it,
boy, do you have potatoes in your ears or something? Answer that door. I'm expecting my good friend. friend, Lord Rosenblum, and he's probably freezing outside there. It's dastardly weather.
By your lordship's expense.
Out of my way, you dolt. Oh, a good day, my lord.
Oh, good day, Rosenblum. Why don't you join me by the fire?
Oh, not much of a blaze today, Lord Skillworth.
We have just about depleted the forest this year.
Oh, but nothing like the winter of 72. We had to burn our servants.
Oh, but a splendid idea, my lord. You there, potato ears, or whatever in blazes your name should be.
Hi, my lordship.
It's your duty to keep his lordship's warm, is it not?
Aye, it is, sir.
Well, into the hearth with you, my lad.
But your lordship...
You joke, you don't, you get impertinent with me, boy. I'll have my manservant beat you to the... In. Oh, forgive me for the scene, Lord Rosenblum. These servants today. Forget the meaning of the word servitude. The nerve of them. My lord, could I offer you a glass of sherry?
Oh, don't mind if I do, my lord. You know, you've given me an idea. I have an aging butler and chambermaid that could make things toastier about the manor.
I should warn you, though, my lord. The older ones give off a dreadful aroma.
Oh, I should remember that, my lord.
You do that, my lord.
Thank you. Can you hear me talking slow, as if I were on the radio? Can you see me talking slow, as if I were on the radio? Not an hour goes by, not a minute, when you are in it. When you are sleeping, you are seeping through.
Listening to the Neo Radio Hour, independent audio art. I'm Peter Donalds. That was a piece called Talkin' Slow by the group High Strangeness, which consists of core members Very Severe and Kathy Goss. And it's time for conversation. This week we talk with Kathy Goss of High Strangeness.
I have been working as a poet, doing a lot of readings around the San Francisco Bay Area for about 10 years, when suddenly I ran into Very Severe over in Oakland, who had been working with musicians and poets for a number of years already, doing spoken word and poetry performance, using spoken word and music performance, creating sort of an ambient musical landscape for the performance of spoken word, where the emphasis was on the poetry rather than on the music. And I immediately latched onto this, and over the next year and some 9 months we've been working together now in a group we call High Strangeness, I discovered this is a really wonderful way to make poetry come alive for audiences that aren't usually exposed to poetry. So that's what I've been doing, and doing it both with High Strangeness and also as a solo recorder and performer. And I just find that it's a great way of reaching people who don't ordinarily listen to poetry, and it really makes it much, much easier to get what you're trying to say across. Of course, not all spoken word performers are trying to get across the kind of messages that we're trying to get across, so the content is very important.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that we find is that doing spoken word rather than sung lyrics, people cannot escape what you're saying. Uncomfortable and unnerving and mind-bending as it may be.
Well, that brings me to, I might as well ask it now, what are you trying to say? Have you got an agenda? I mean, a lot of artists don't want to say that. They don't want to say, I have an agenda. I don't have,
you know, it's my art. I'm not necessarily trying to get across any message. But you've got something to say.
Yeah, I think that we circle around a number of primary themes which arise out of our own life experience and our own interests and even our hobbies. I guess what we could say is that we're living right now in a world where there's a lot of polarization going on and people are being sort of set up against each other. Let's see, we have the haves and the have-nots, the left and the right, black and white, immigrants and natives and labor and management and all these kinds of things. And there are a lot of things that transcend those dichotomies and carry a much deeper and more lasting truth. So one of the areas that we're really interested in is ancient teachings, which very often, as you look at them, turn out to be in some way literally true. And here we are approaching the millennium, and there are a lot of ancient prophecies that say all hell's going to break loose, and we look around and we see maybe they might have been right. So a lot of the ancient texts seem to carry some wisdom that is very relevant right now. And tying into this is sort of a hobbyist interest, I guess I might say, in subjects like UFOs and weird science and suppressed science. I've done a lot of writing in holistic health, and so I know from many years of experience that there are certain things that we just aren't allowed to know. And that one of the things we aren't allowed to know is that we can really do a lot of things for ourselves that we've sort of surrendered to professionals. And this is certainly true in health, and it's certainly true now in this sort of conspiracy theory community that people are saying we want to have control of our information and our communications, and we want to be able to speak to each other, and we don't want to be told this pack of lies. So this makes for very interesting subject matter and very entertaining subject matter, this blending of different concerns like this. And we do it all with very good humor. I don't think we want people to think we're making fun of the subject matter, but we also don't want them to think that we're absolutely dead serious. We want it to be entertaining.
Do you have any personal experience with weird science, any sort of supernatural experiences, UFOs, that sort of thing?
I had one UFO sighting down in Big Sur a number of years ago. I don't really attach that much significance to it because it was just seeing something. It wasn't having any kind of close encounter. But it looked to me as if it was a technology that allowed things to pop in and out of physical manifestation. That was very much what it looked to me. And it was before the current fad for seeing UFOs. So I think what I saw was really genuine. And I know that Big Sur is one of the areas where that happens a lot. But no, I wouldn't say that. I'd say that I've had really compelling experiences with things like homeopathy and human energies and that sort of thing, because that's a very practical kind of application of some of these principles, and there I've seen things working. But I haven't made a big deal of going to seances or table rappings or mind reading. Some of those things happen in our everyday lives, and I think that it's best to just accept them as part of what goes on and not to attach a lot of significance to them.
You're listening to the Neo Radio Hour. I'm Peter Donaldson, in conversation tonight with Kathy Goss, writer, performer, solo artist, and member of the group High Strangeness. We're going to hear now another piece by that group, High Strangeness. That's Kathy Goss in collaboration with Very Severe and various other musicians. And then we'll get back and pick up on our conversation. It's the Neo Radio Hour, independent audio art.
I really miss the Middle Ages, the bands of black-robed fanatics wandering the countryside, gaunt and stern. The pure ones, the Cathari, who through secret practices of breathing and fasting know themselves as beings of light. Light imprisoned in flesh by an evil creator God.
Step right up, folks.
Medieval period.
We've got our own private jet. Come forward if you want to see Jesus of Nazareth.
Who is the Holy Spirit?
Probably from among the Arabs.
We've got a Swiss chalet.
It's quite an elaborate system. Derives, for the most part, from the older Jews. After the Renaissance, the travelers became an intellectual group.
I really miss the 12th century. A cult of suicide by starvation, a vow never to marry, nor to consume the products of procreation, no meat, nor milk, nor eggs.
You too want to be of the chosen few to emulate yourself for the Lord. Step forward.
A heresy so powerful that 400, surrounded on a hillside by crusaders, stepped singing into the flames. No happier death than a death by fire.
Very dark eyes. Very uniform collar. I see a collar.
We've got automatic weapons. And the Holy Grail! It's a mandate from the Lord! Step forward!
I really miss the Inquisition. Neighbor denouncing neighbor. Confessions extracted by torture. Confiscation of land and chattels.
Jesus of Nazareth. Don't you want to go on that joyride in the sky?
Came principally from Orthodox Jewish people who felt that a heresy
I really
was
miss the Black
midst.
Plague.
Inasmuch
dark lesions on the skin followed by certain death
came into the cabalistic pattern.
One third of the continent gone.
Regarded as producing the same effect then as some pseudo-mystical work.
The Holy Spirit is a boiling spirit. It kindles the hearts of humankind. Like tympanum and lyre, it plays them, gathering volumes in the temple of the soul. The Holy Spirit resurrects and awakes everything that is.
By this time, it had attracted to itself.
I really miss the Middle Ages. It will never be the same again.
Once again, that's High Strangeness. You're listening to the Neo Radio Hour. I'm Peter Donalds, and we were speaking with Kathy Goss, founding member of the group. Let's pick up on that conversation now. As we left off, we were talking about one of their favorite bits of subject matter, UFOs, weird science, and that sort of thing. Along that same line, the weirdness of it, I guess the only place we hear a lot of these things are from very tainted sources, tabloids, TV daytime talk shows, that sort of thing. I think it's great to explore that sort of thing in a format that's not of that ilk. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, right. Well, I think that some of the sources are tainted, and some of them. One of the things that I think is happening, if I can launch into sort of a conspiratorial perspective, is that information is being allowed to reach us through very clearly predetermined channels. And so if it's the tabloid's job this week to talk about space aliens in Congress, and it's the tabloid TV talk shows to talk about sex with chickens and things like that, it's not because those are the only arenas where these things can be discussed, but because that's the way that it's been parceled out by an increasingly consolidating mass media. I don't think it's any accident where these things are coming out. I think it's all part of a larger, not necessarily a conspiracy, but there's like different levels of media that reach different parts of our consciousness and different parts of the public. And we're being fed information, for example, about UFOs in a lot of subtle ways, now even not so subtle, that may just be ways of breaking the news to us that they're here and that we better learn how to deal with it. So the fact that it's in the tabloids today doesn't mean that it's not going to be on the front page of the New York Times tomorrow.
So as an artist, do you put much stock in the notion of high art and low art? I mean, since you're using humor and dealing with kind of weird subject matter,
I think I can maybe respond to what you're saying. First of all, I take myself very seriously as a poet. High Strangeness as a group takes itself very seriously in producing the work that we produce as individual little gem-like pieces. They may not fit on our Eurocentric concert stage, and this is part of the problem that we're having, is that there is no particular category for what we're doing. We've been to a number of music industry conferences and tried to find who we're supposed to talk to about this, and there really isn't any place to go. We can't go and talk to the rap people because they definitely have an agenda of their own. If you just do spoken word without music, that's an entirely different thing. But you go back to the ancient bardic tradition, and I think we're doing something that's very similar to what the ancient bards were doing. They both sang and spoke their long tales to the accompaniment of music, sometimes playing the music themselves, sometimes working with other musicians. And there was as you know probably from the Pythagorean theory of music, there was a very detailed science behind the effect that music had on the human psyche. And we may not be as precise and scientific, but what we're trying to do is something that is appropriate for today's audiences, that moves beyond this enshrinement of art as something sacred and something that you can even make distinctions between high and low. If we're trying to wake people up, then you have to speak to people in the idiom that they're used to hearing. And so I don't really see that what we're doing is low art or folk art or anything. It's just an art that addresses contemporary concerns in a language that can reach a wide audience, hopefully. And in the process, turn their minds around and get them to experience images and sensations and bouncing around in time that wouldn't be accessible to them if they were lectured at. Or it's more like some Japanese musician friends of ours say it's like a comic strip, some of the ways that we conjure up images.
So are you making any money?
Not yet. Not yet. We're having fun. Would like to attract a label that would want to do a CD with us, because we've turned out, High Strangeness has turned out 3 tapes, pretty well produced, and I've turned out 1 solo tape. And unfortunately, it's hard to get played on the air even without having a CD. And so we're hoping that somebody will want to record a CD with us and that we can then have access to a wider audience and find venues that are most appropriate for us to perform in. Right now, we've been performing mainly in the poetry scene, and I guess it's no secret that the poetry scene isn't a big money maker. I do think that there are a lot of clubs that are appropriate for our material, places that have really good sound systems and attentive audiences who are willing to experience something new and different. Certainly among college audiences, I think that we have a market. So hopefully we will make a little money at this.
Yeah, and in the meantime, it's not getting you down. I mean, you're feeling good about what you're doing.
Well, yeah, we'd like to be moving faster in getting out to a wider audience, but it's all fun, and we're right now working on a lot of material that's quite topical, that's responding to events that are going on at a frantic pace in the world around us.
So you're still doing your writing, your day job, as it were?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And how big of a conflict is that? What's the time? What's your typical day like? You
well,
have to spend most of your time on that?
Well, I've been lucky because most of the work that I do as a writer has fed my poetry. I don't really even make a distinction between the two, except that I get paid for some of this and some of it I don't. But I've been very fortunate over the years to work with a number of people who have actually turned me on to areas that then became material that I would use in my poetry. And so right now, for example, I'm doing some work on the medical applications of cannabis products with a psychiatrist who's been promoting this idea for years.
How did you escape the fate of, you know, 90% of the rest of us who, you know, watch TV and go to work and don't think about all this high strangeness? What brought you to this, do you think? Let's do a little self-analysis.
Well, I don't know. I grew up in a very small town in New York State. Very small school. Most of the people there, I could tell as I was growing up, were pretty much asleep. And so to express my rebellious nature, I started reading weird poetry when I was a kid and did all the things that good little students are supposed to do. But I also had this whole private part of me that developed and explored in areas that would allow me to express this rebellion. And being somebody who grew up in the 60s, I got to practice rebellion pretty heavily once I got into college. And I was in graduate school in Berkeley during the student revolution. So I went through a lot of stuff that was definitely an opportunity to express that rebellious spirit. And never really was afraid to have attitudes and opinions and interests that ran counter to the mainstream, although I certainly have gotten more confident about doing that in more recent years. But I think the other thing is, I think for some reason I haven't been entirely driven by the fear of what's going to happen tomorrow or what's going to happen next month or how am I going to support myself when I'm 90 years old. I mean, certainly these things hang over all of us, but if we can live a little more in the present and be a little more playful, I think that life can be a lot richer and we can't let the boss run our trip quite so much.
What do you think of the current state of rebellion in this country, or at least in your circle?
Well, I think it's very
especially
interesting
in art.
Because over the years, in certain areas, I have found, although I guess I've always sort of, without giving it much thought, I always characterized my political leanings as being to the left. In some areas where I would be working, like in alternative medicine, I would find myself very much in bed with people from the John Birch Society because they were espousing principles of individual choice and freedom of choice in health care, and it was the Birchers who brought a lot of the alternative cancer treatments into this country, and I always found that sort of embarrassing. And now we're seeing the same kind of thing going on with the militia movement, and the fact that the militia movement people and the sovereign citizenship movement and these kinds of things which are associated with the right maybe aren't really, maybe that's not where those things really need to be placed, and maybe we're keeping these false distinctions because it's in the interest of the powers that be to keep people divided. I think one day a lot of us are going to wake up and find we have a lot of common causes. And while I don't think that we're ever going to be able to get together on certain issues, certain touchy things like abortion or the drug laws, these are all pretty tough issues. In other areas, I think that there's a real populist rebellion going on right now, and that rather than oppose what's going on, rather than take sides about a lot of these things, it's going to be useful to stand back a little bit and see where we can apply a little bit of leverage and get some of our, if we do have an agenda, to get some of that pushed through, because we have more allies than we realize at this point. But I definitely think that the organized rebellion, if there is such a thing in this country right now, looks like it's coming more from what we would in the past have called the right. And I find that very interesting. But I also think that it's something that's being partly manipulated by the media. And so we have to be careful when we talk about it that we're not mistaking illusion for real reality out there.
Right. And you may or may not agree, but organized rebellion is usually not what brings about change.
That's
it's,
right.
It's the rebellion that bubbles up from, you know, we're unaware of for a long time.
Right. And I think that in the creative arts, we have a chance to really make powerful statements. And if people can turn off their televisions or at least pull their brains away from it long enough to pay attention to some of the creative work that's going on out in communities these days, they might find a richer food for their spirit than the stuff that's being fed to them. And I think, you know, things like the internet also I have mixed feelings about, because on the one hand, it does give people a sense of power and freedom to be whatever they want to be and to find people who share their interests. But on the other hand, there you are again sitting looking at a computer screen. And I don't think that's really living life to the fullest.
That brings me to something else I wanted to ask you. You obviously use a bit of technology in your work, in your music and poetry. How much technology do you use? What level are you at? And do you enjoy the technological end of it?
Yeah, I've always been sort of a computer phobe, so it's been hard for me to work my way even into using a computer for writing, but I'm certainly past that now. In High Strangeness, we do something very interesting, very severe. My fellow poet and musician, he and I are the core of the group, plays ancient instruments that are definitely primitive in design. The most powerful thing that he plays is the birimbau, which is the South American musical bow that's used, for example, in capoeira, and it's a popular instrument in Brazil. But all it really does is play one note, or if you want to allow for the fretting possibilities on it, maybe two notes. And yet what he does is he runs that through a guitar synthesizer and gets all kinds of strange sounds and effects with it. He does the same thing with the kalimba, the African thumb piano, and with the kaminandi, which is an African harp. I play a T3, Korg T3 synthesizer, and I'm using a lot of sampled sounds from a wonderful outfit back in Connecticut who sample unusual instruments and old analog synthesizers. But because I'm just pretty much playing the keyboard, I'm able to exploit this technology without having to learn too much about it. I guess the next step is to go on and get into MIDI, but I'm a little reluctant to do that because I would rather be spending my time writing poetry and getting the music that I hear in my head out into the air rather than messing around with computers. So at some point I'll probably have to get into MIDI, but I'm not doing that yet.
I love your positive aura that I'm getting here over the microphone.
Oh,
in my headphones. I mean, you know, because, I mean, obviously, I don't have to tell you, you're struggling as an artist, I mean, economically. You're doing something that's very unusual. You're definitely a bit of an activist, you know. You're to the left. I mean, these are a lot of reasons that other people would get kind of ornery.
Mm-hmm.
And you're anything but ornery. And I think that's great.
Well, thank you.
So keep it up.
Okay.
All right.
Thanks a lot.
Writer and performer Kathy Goss in conversation. You're listening to the Neo Radio Hour. I'm Peter Donalds. And speaking of ornery, time now for the caustic, yet affable, Mr. Sunshine.
So, how are American kids doing these days? Well, all the studies show they're overweight, watch too much TV, they know who Joe Camel is, but they can't name the president. Nearly half of all households are headed by a single parent, and the two-parent home usually means two working parents, and a good number of them are having a tough time making ends meet. Chances are you live in such a house. If you don't, try to imagine flipping widgets all day, then coming home to shopping, laundry, bill juggling, cooking and cleaning, etc., ad nauseum. Say you got two or three kids. How great of a parent can you be? How about the schools? Schools are funded in most states by property taxes, so rich communities have good schools and poor communities have shitty schools. Yeah, that's fair. In the state where I live, the public schools are at or near the top of the nation every year. But still, the inner city schools in the biggest city suck. Gee, you think inner city poverty might have something to do with it? That's a tough one. Better get a commission to do another 5-year study. Of course, the bleeding heart solution is just to provide more money for schools and better pay for teachers. Who? Who's going to pay the tab for that? You're dreaming if you think you're going to get it from Uncle Sham. And the political battle cry of the 90s? Personal responsibility. Bull nostrils. Personal responsibility is code for you're on your own, pal. You didn't really buy that of, by, and for the people thing, did you? Let me tell you something. When I'm working from 9 a.m. to midnight to keep a roof over my family's head, and I've done it, no self-righteous, pseudo-religious, neo-moralist, chauffeur-driven, silver-spoon-up-his-ass politician is going to chastise me for not monitoring my kids' television or helping them with their phonics. Mr. Speaker, you don't think parents want to be with their children, love them, nurture them, teach them values? Of course we do, you inbred, bloated, pock-faced, double-chinned, million-dollar book deal waste of a good suit. Parents will do their job when this economy can provide a living wage for a reasonable work week. Schools will do better only when poverty and its attendant social problems are reduced. And none of this is going to happen through bully pulpit moralizing or by neo-New Deal whining for a bigger piece of the pie. The pie is old. Gone bad. It's rotten. It's time to bake a new one. If my little pie metaphor is too oblique, I'll put it as clearly as I can. See, both the right and the left in this country operate on the basic assumption that everything has to be bought and paid for. That's the recipe for the rotten pie. The right looks for solutions that'll pay off. The left is always looking for what they like to call social investment. But either way, right or left, the books have to balance. It's all based on money. Educating poor children is never going to be a big moneymaker, and whining to Washington for more money is like the slave asking the plantation owner's wife for more rice. Oops, there I go with metaphors again. See, the government can only dole out a few cents per child for schools and daycare because it's married to the guys who make the profits, and there ain't much tangible return on social programs. Liberals try to appeal to the right by touting the long-range economic benefit of social spending. Healthy, educated children will grow up to be productive workers with disposable incomes, they say. I don't know about you, but to surrender the intrinsic value of health, education, and children in order to quantify some equation for profits really burns my clams. No matter. The argument bounces off a conservative like a 4-day meatball. This country works for kids like it works for the rest of us. Some of them will do fine. Learn good manners. Go to Harvard. One of them will become president. But the rest of them, they're on their own, as long as we assume that every social policy has to bow to the forces of money. The books don't have to balance. I know it's not easy to question fundamental assumptions, but once you do it, it gets a lot easier. So good luck with your kids. I think mine are okay, because the other day I was sitting on the couch with my 2-year-old. I farted, and he said, "Good one, Dad." I must be doing something right. This is Mr. Sunshine.
Neo Radio Hour is written and produced by Peter Donalds and Frank Skillman. Contributing artists, Leon Rosen, The Bohypnics, Pussy Tourette, and High Strangeness. In conversation tonight, it was writer and performer Kathy Goss. If you'd like more information about Kathy's work with High Strangeness and her partner Very Severe, you can contact her at area 415-648-0774. I know they have tapes available and would be happy to hear from you. Our address remains the same. If you'd like to contact us for any reason, comments about the show, suggestions, questions, and best of all, contributions of work, I'll remind you, as I always do, that everything you hear on the show is contributed by independent writers, musicians, and artists. And if you've got some work you'd like to share with us, or if we've inspired you to get in the studio, that'd be great. It's the Neo Radio Hour, independent audio art. Thanks for listening. I hope you taped it. I'm Peter Donalds.